the change in Tracy's life. I remember when somebody would cross Tracy's path, that she would beat them within an inch of their lives and walk away. When Tracy first started attending this membership, I remember she would call me after she had pistol whipped people. And she would come and tell me about it. And I didn't know what to do. I thought to call the police. But what she was doing was crying out and saying, "Pastor, I don't want to be like that anymore." So we started a love journey with her. We began to love her unconditionally. And over time, her attitude changed. She began to ask for worship music so that she could listen to it. She asked me to come over and pray in the house and in the building because there were demons trying to get her. She began to try to draw closer to the Lord. You know what the Lord told me? She was writing the last chapter of her life. Every one of us will begin to write the last chapter of your life. And the question today is not how long the chapter is, but what is the content of the chapter? Are you going to spend your time talking about how you're going through, how things ain't working out, how every time I look up, somebody trying to do something to me? Are you going to do like Tracy started to do? I know God is with me because I didn't hurt this person today. I feel the love of God in my life because I feel good about who I am, and I know what I used to be, and I can see the change coming in my life. Is on my back, but greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I know the devil is real, but I know my God is real. I begin to see God for who he is, because God showed me the devil for who he is, and I decided that I would make Jesus my choice. That's what you call writing the end of a great life. Today to contribute to the last chapter. The question today is, are you in the will of God or are you out of the will of God? You have to decide that. You have to determine that. And when you do, you begin to write on the things that you're experiencing in this last chapter. Tomorrow is not promised to any of us. So what you don't want to miss is the opportunity to say that I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. I don't think you can get in on the boilerplate paragraph in obituaries that say they accepted Christ at an early age. It's got to be more than that. A relationship with Christ is every day. If the last time you talked to him was when you met him at an early age, you got some catching up to do. I call it boilerplate because we default to that. But there's no other meat in the context that supports that statement. What will your epitaph read? You have a privilege today of contributing to that document. She lived a good life. She gave her life to the Lord. She worked diligently for the kingdom. He was admirable. He was favorable. He was friendly. He loved everybody. What are they going to say about you? You lay before this altar. I just need you to think about that for a moment. In just a few moments, I'm going to invite you to the altar. I'm going to ask you to meet us here. I'm going to ask that God will touch your heart as he's ordained for today. Don't be ashamed. Don't worry about what people are saying or thinking. It don't even matter because you're trying to get your joy back. You're determined to be happy again. You're going to be diligent about reconnecting with God because you want to be able to smile again and not have to fake it. You We want to live according to the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, that guides your heart and your mind. You want to experience the love of God that is unconditional. You want to experience the joy of God that Paul said is unspeakable and full of glory. That's your mindset this morning. That's your attitude. I don't care about what's going on the outside. Baby, I just want to live in peace. I want to be able to get up and not have to worry about tomorrow. Because I know who holds my hand today. That's where I am right now. Don't let nobody push you to hell. Don't let nobody drag you away from God. Snatch away and say, "For God, I live, and for God, I have." As you're considering where you are in your own life, as you are pondering right now whether I've been talking to you or about you, you still have to make a choice. And this invitation is extended on a daily basis. So don't think that tomorrow or next week you'll have this opportunity, because you may not. This may be the only chance that you get. Don't waste it. I want you to consider where you are right now. God is not asking for perfection. God is not asking for you to be all together now. He just wants one thing: a willing heart. And if you're willing to be made willing, the altar is open for you. If you're in this room today, you know you need to make a change in your life. The altar is open for you. If you're here today, you know you've made some mistakes, but you don't want to live the rest of your life depressed, oppressed, broken, and broken-spirited. And there's an opportunity for you to be restored. The altar is open for you right now. Choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Will you come? Wherever you are, I want to extend the invitation. I want you to know that God is calling you. God has reached out for you today. David is again our vessel. He's showing us that God